Good evening, everyone. We're going to get started in about one more minute. Thanks for joining. All right. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today. Tonight, Dr. Abari Cartman, the Association of Black Psychologists and Friends, will kick off the first of the Hip Hop Wellness series. We're so excited and we're surely in for some thoughtful dialogue and call to action. Before we jump into it, I'm Nakia. I serve as a health educator here at the Blue Door Neighborhood Center. And on behalf of the entire department, we thank you for joining us tonight. For those of you who are not already aware of the Blue Door Neighborhood Center, we are Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Illinois' first ever neighborhood center. And we're very passionate about positively impacting community health. We do this in a variety of ways, but most intimately through health and wellness focused programming, classes, workshops, and events much like this one here today. These are offered at no cost to anyone in the community. And for those who we were thinking it, no, you do not have to be Blue Cross and Blue Shield members in order to participate. We currently have three physical locations in three of Chicago's neighborhoods, Pullman, Morgan Park, and South Londo. Although currently we operate out of this virtual platform and we love to do it, I just want to take a moment to pause and acknowledge some of my teammates, our director, LaRon Taylor, our managers of health education, Tarakisha Hammond and Jess Torres, my fellow health educators, Paige Hampton, Akia Nguyen, Ashley Lewis, and any other Blue Cross Blue Shield of Illinois colleagues. Thank you all for joining us. We are surely in for a treat. I just wanted to highlight here, we want to connect with you. So this month we've been focused on heart health and Black History Month. We'd love if you would join us for any of our upcoming events. We have two dope events that are happening right this week. Tomorrow night is virtual family game night. And of course our Black History program on Saturday. You can register right on our website. And you can follow us at Blue Door Neighborhood Center on Facebook, or go visit our website, bluedoorcenteril.com. Go ahead, grab your phones. This is a good screen to screenshot or take a photo of. One more thing before we jump into it. At the end of tonight, we would love your feedback. We actually value it. It helps to inform how we do our programming here. So go ahead and take another screenshot or picture or write down this survey. I'll put it in the chat as well. We'd love to hear your feedback. And finally, a little virtual housekeeping. This meeting will be recorded, so just a heads up on that. You can also change your view when we're not sharing content on the screen. You can see all of our participants and visitors in the grid view, or if you prefer to see the active viewer, the choice is up to you. And then your lines will be muted, but when the opportunity arises, we would love for you to unmute yourself if you'd like to share something. And then finally, but not least, some of you have already started the conversation in the chat box. We will be using this tonight, throughout the night. So go ahead, find the chat box. Let us know your name and where you're joining us from. We'd love to hear it. And then also throughout the night, we would love if you have any feedback, questions, comments. We'd love to share it here in the chat box. That's all I've got for you. We are in for a good discussion tonight with Dr. Abari. And Doc, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and the floor is yours.
Fantastic. Thank you, Nakia. Thank you, Blue Door, for having us again, for allowing us to use your space to curate innovative discussions and push the boundaries. When they asked about doing something for Black History Month, I was like, y'all want to do something safe and fun and pretty, or y'all want to go there? Like, we want to go there for real or not? So it was like, let's do it. So here we are, and I appreciate y'all, you know what I'm saying, recognizing the need to have, you know, real conversations and do real work. So I appreciate y'all for that. And so before I begin, I just want to pause for a moment and start with a moment of silence to recognize the gratitude of this conversation. This is not light work, that my attempt here in gathering today is to do service, to with integrity, honor our ancestors, to honor those who made the sacrifices that if they did not choose to live, to survive the most horrific crime against humanity that the world has seen, then most of us would not be here now. So an acknowledgement of them and their sacrifice and their work. And then I'm hoping that this conversation serves in the aim of honoring them, of bringing light to their sacrifices, their brilliance, and the power that we have by being connected to them. So that is the whole point of this conversation. So before I begin, I wanted to have a moment of silence for wherever you are, be connected in this virtual space, to find a moment to take some deep breaths and get grounded and pray or meditate or center yourself however you feel grounds you and allows those entities that we're inviting to this conversation that we represent to be included in this conversation. So pause for that cause for a moment. Okay, thank you. So I'm first going to talk about the intention for this whole series, the Hip Hop Wellness series. We understand that folks is tired of Zooms and we don't want to come doing more panels. We want to have this be as interactive and engaging as possible. And we're using the technology to its full advantage. And we want to make this a space that feels more like a workshop where we're going to play a lot of music, share videos, and ask, you know, us to really in real time reflect on what we think, what we feel, how we respond to it. At the end of this series, well, I would like for people to be able to have an enhanced toolkit of songs, music. If you work with young people, if you got kids, if you want to try to use the YouTubes or whatever it is in the virtual space to be more engaging, we're going to use the space to workshop some material. So I'm going to share what I find. If y'all got other stuff, y'all can bring that. But we really want to like fine tooth comb look at these material. I don't want this to be a thing we're rushing through. I want us to really, as a group, as a community, explore the usefulness of art and culture in conversations about wellness using different topics. And I'm going to bring in guests and guest artists and rappers. And tonight, we're lucky to have somebody who's in the field and also an artist. We get to meet her soon. So every week, every month, we're going to have a different topic using hip hop, playing videos, playing music. Looking at lyrics, printing out lyrics, having artists share the intention behind their work, and finding ways to integrate that in conversations about mental health, so that when we're talking about the stigma and the increase in services, it's not always so dry and sad. These conversations will be sad after a while. So I want to try to bring some energy to this and use hip hop as the vehicle that connects us to our culture, and using the drums and the power of spoken word and the oral tradition to highlight the connections between healing practices that we've always leaned on, and make that a contemporary, you know, conversation connecting to the mental health movement. So today's topic is understanding ways to use hip hop to discuss the traumas of enslavement and other parts of Black history that do not reinforce shame, that leave students, that leave communities with a sense of pride and power, and understand the true like nature of those circumstances. Because in Black History Month, you know, we all notice that we hear the same stories over and again, we see the same figures, and in some way there's a really important attempt to retell the stories of what happened to us that highlight, you know, the traumas that we experience. But I think sometimes, even with good intention, have mental health consequences that we also need to be aware of. So I wanted to have that discussion today. How do we tell this story? How do we remember what happened to us without propping up the enemy of our people, right? How do we do this without making the so-called oppressors look more powerful? How do we not encourage our young people to align with the winners of the story by telling it over and over again in ways that make us feel like beaten down and weak and passive and submitting to it the whole time? And I think that it's important to tell the stories, but I think the way in which we tell it is really important. So there's a couple of examples of artists, of rappers, of hip hop videos that are using the slavery experience to talk about different aspects of that history. Some I think do it better than others, but I want us to look at it and to talk about it and feel through it. There's a lot of songs I want to share today. So at least in the beginning, we're going to rely heavily on the chat for your reflections. So as I play music, please, you know, chime in, tell me, you know, what you think the intentions of the artists are, how you feel, how you're responding. We talked a little bit before we opened the floor to just whether or not we wanted to, after each song, open for reflection. But there's so much like emotional content that I didn't want to get derailed by conversation. So we're going to contain the conversation to the chat for now, try to get through some of the content, and then leave enough time in the end for just open discussion. We format these webinars very deliberately to not have like the panelists and then like an audience in secret. We want everybody to be able to unmute, take your video off, say what you want to say. We want to try to mimic as much as a in-person conversation as possible. But before we get to that part, I'm going to share some thanks. And I will begin now. Optimize for motion video. Can y'all see my screen? Cool. So this is the opening example of the framework that I want to present and have us sort of look at today. This is a clip from Spike Lee movie, Black Klansman. And in the clip, he has Harry Belafonte sort of telling the story and, you know, set the thing up. You see, he's telling a story to what you assume would be some Black Panthers or just, you know, people in the, you know, Black Power movement at the time. And you see sort of this collaboration of these powerful figures and Harry Belafonte's attempt to, Harry Belafonte, what's his name? Is that Harry Belafonte? And his attempt to try to remember the tragedy that happens to us. And you hear in the audience the, man, dang. And then he's juxtaposing that storytelling of our history with the Klan. And there's a tone that I got. I was even in the movies, I remember feeling like I didn't like the way he put that together. That this really represents the whole conversation I want us to have about how do you tell this story in a way that does not make us deflated, right? Does not leave us victimized over and over again. How can we remember these, our ancestors, in a way that gives us and our young people some power so that we want to reconnect, so that we want to seek out these stories, so that it doesn't create more distance. You hear people these days say, I don't want to see no more slave movies. I don't want to hear no more slave stories, because the way we tell it, I think, has a certain tone. And I want to look at that. I want to use sort of this clip to open up the framework, but also using hip hop to really look through how to do that in a way that has some care, right? It has the intention to create power and connection and not just like remind us of tragedy. So this is the beginning of that framework for me. Let me play a little bit of this.
He was 17, I was 18. I kind of looked at Jesse and called him slow. Today, you'd call him mentally retarded. They claimed Jesse raped and murdered a white woman by the name of Lucy Fryer. They put Jesse on trial and is convicted by an all-white jury after they deliberated for only 4 minutes.
My brothers in Christ, Nobel Prize recipient, co-creator of the transistor, and a dear friend of mine, Dr. William Shockley, whose groundbreaking scientific work ushered in the computer age, has proven through his research with eugenics that each of us here has flowing through our veins the genes of a superior race. It's a fact. It's a fact. It can't be disputed. Today, we celebrate that truth.
Masks off, hoods on.
I was working across the street at the Shoeshine Parlor. And after the verdict, the mob grabbed Jesse, put a chain around his neck, and dragged him out of the courthouse. I knew I had to hide.
That way. Be careful, brother.
Well, all right.
Where I was, the shoe parlor had a window up in the attic, and I could see the crowd. They marched as he through the streets. They stabbed him and beat him. And finally, in a bloody heap, they held him down in the street and cut off his testicles.
God, give us true white men. The invisible empire demands strong minds, gray hearts, true faith, clean and ready hands. Men who have honor. Men who will not lie. Men who can stand before a demagogue and damn his treacherous flatteries without blinking. God, give us real men. Courageous men who flinch not at duty. Men of dependable character, men of sterling worth. Then wrongs will be redressed and right shall rule the earth. God, give us true white men. Ron Stallworth, rise.
So, y'all get the point. What's happening, and he goes back and forth. And I think the intention is to show the Klan as evil, as vicious, and show white people as the villain. But I think what happens subtly in the way we tell the stories is that they look kind of powerful, and that they look like they have pride in themselves. And, you know, in the movie, you see them taking care of their families. And if the story is over and over again, if you look back in history, is that we've been, you know, getting our ass beat over and over again for centuries, and then have these images of lynchings, have these images of getting beat, have these all these images in our mind of loss. And then today still, we replay the Laquan McDonald's, the Mike Browns, we still seeing the images of just black bodies slain over and over again. And I feel like that has some impact on our psyche. I think it does some damage that I don't want us to look at. I want us to think about, to figure out what are some other ways that we can tell these stories that does not leave new scars and that does not re-traumatize us over and over again and instill in us a sense of pride and power so that we can, you know, go to the stories and be proud of these stories and not ashamed of these stories. So I got two videos. I'm gonna play two videos. I'm not gonna play the whole thing. I don't wanna spend too much time on them, but they are two contemporary young rappers that the young people are really into, YG and Young Dolph, if y'all got young people and know who they listen to. Both of them decided to tell sort of contemporary stories. The first story is about snitching, which is a conversation I think we also need to have. And the second story is about the record industry. And I'm not gonna say what I feel about it. I'm just gonna share them and just without commentary. But these are two examples of, you know, new versions of the enslaved African story. And whether or not they're done with care, whether or not they had good intentions, the execution of them, I think has implications for our young people's psychology. I just want to talk about that. If there's comments in the chat, if y'all have a reaction to it, please share. There's language, there's images, you know, it's like, it's rap music. So like, it's hard to do this without, you know what I'm saying, some profanity and some explicit content. So We're just going to play it flat out. And I just want to know what y'all see, what y'all hear, whether or not it does is reverence to our ancestors, whether or not it's disrespectful. You know, again, without putting my position on it, I just wanted to see what other people feel when they watch and engage some of these young rappers' expression of the slave story. So that's a YG. This is my fourth time watching it. I'm still not exactly sure what the story is. I had a hard time following it, so maybe somebody can help me, somebody that speaks hip-hop more fluently than I. I couldn't tell if they escaped, if they were just the whole thing was just like a lesson to teach him for snitching. Some of the things that I wonder about is like about how snitching has evolved in our communities, what it means to, when I was growing up, it just meant like if you do something with your people and then like you trick on the crew that you were with after somebody got caught, then that was a very narrow version of snitching. But right now it just means like talking to the authorities in any way, even if you got like information about murder that you had nothing to do with. So I mean, all of this is information to talk through and try to figure out. But I'm gonna quickly go to another one. If y'all can just share your thoughts. I love the chat. I'm watching the chat too. So please make sure y'all engage in. We multi-sensory engaging here. Text, chat, music, video, all of this happening at the same time. So here's another one. This one's a little bit more graphic. So y'all just joined us. We're just using these illustrations of music that our young folks are listening to. And I firmly believe we got to stay tuned in. You know, they're gonna be exposed to this content with or without us. So we need to try to at least be a part of the conversation so that we can help shape how they interpret it. Because art can be interpreted so many different ways, and that we want to be able to use, you know, experience and wisdom and study to be able to have good outcomes as they're experiencing art, particularly when corporations are in control of the artists and the art they produce. Another conversation also. This is a Young Dolph talking about the record industry.
If you could only see one film this year, make it
Young Dolph, Slave Owner.
Whole lot of drill. Money calling back to back, so I keep taking trips. Spend a couple mil, just on one crib. Hold up, let me crack the seal, take another sip. Whole lot of drill. Whole lot of drill. Whole lot of trip. I'm a slave owner. Whole lot of whip. I don't like niggas. I might get him killed. He like popping pills. I like counting mills.
From the man who brought you Preach, Get Paid, and the scathing Play With Your Bitch, Young Dolph in Slave Owner.
Now, who is this nigga riding green on his ass? That there man is gonna make Liberty Land live some money. Who? That looks good ass nigga right there. That man right there. Not in Liberty Land.
In Liberty Land.
Not the big house.
The big house.
Who is the big Liberty Land? Home of the Ben South Fire. First
Friday,
and that is Matthew.
It's Dolph.
She like popping piss, bro. I like throwing paper. Yeah. That boy, they'll push. Yeah. Cause that nigga hater won't show up in all black. Yeah. Like the countertop. Designer everything. Diamond watch and diamond ring. Yeah, you right. I'm such a big deal. Rose Royce on some big wheels. I had to hustle for my bitch. I'm at the field. Streets balling in Chirac like I'm Coach Phil. Drop a pill in her drink like beer. Whoa. Smash her on the first night. I bet I will. I'm gonna get up in this car, take off them heels. I'm on my whole truck low. I just made a deal. Hey. What's the business? What's the motherfucking word? It was pop. Put a dick in your ear. Fuck what you heard. Another check just clear. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. How the hell? Ain't gon' get you nowhere. Whole lot of drill. Money calling back to back, so I keep taking trips. Spend a couple mil, just on one crib. Hold up, let me
owner.
Back during slavery, there was two kinds of slaves. There was the house Negro and the field Negro. The house Negro, they lived in the house. They dressed pretty good. They ate good, because they ate his food. What's that?
Desert Slave, Unlimited Land Records. Oh, we gon' have your entire ass in. In fact, we all got the same bank account.
All the other artists that came here, they're doing great. And you too can do just as good as them. Even better.
See, no change you got on what? Oh, they must do shiny. Yo, we got some change for you. Oh, yeah. We got some change for your ass. And you gon' depend on Liberty Land for everything.
So, that's enough of that. It goes a little bit longer. But I do believe that he was trying to make a point that the slavery metaphor is applied to the record industry, and that the sort of white corporations are trying to make slaves out of the artists. I think he was, that's the point that I think he's trying to make. You know, whether or not I think that he has the right to use Malcolm X's voice and invoke that story is a different question. And whether or not he did it well, I don't know. I didn't love it, but y'all feel free to chime in and share your own thoughts. I quickly want to go to another video that I appreciated a little bit better. D-Smoke is an artist. So just to wash the taste out of our mouth with D-Smoke.
And finds himself in human form. He denies himself to find true wealth within. In his tribe, his health is prized possession. Sin is diverting from that rugged path that leads to the truth that he is I and I am we.
Super good. Ain't go fun. Purple rain falling down on the prince of the coast where the sunshine all year round. Purple haze over landscape, still I hydrate in the lunch line. With the smog and clouds, what, start me out. This song's in the key of life, and love is in need of more. Young nigga from Inglewood, barefoot on the cedar floor. If black music is the blood, then my heart has been beating more. Rapidly, happily, I look back on a Phoenix Shakur. Her son paved the way, now all eyes on me. Cause I'm young, black, and gifted, Nina, all eyes gon' see. If you swung back my face with a challenge, that's meant to break you on balance scales. You ain't average, now throw your hands on three. Gon' put them up.
Black magic, black excellence, black habits. This black medicine, everything
black. Black tracks, everything.
Everything
black. Black love, everything.
Praise black Jesus, play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still give black roses. Everything
black, child, black pride, everything.
Everything
black, pride, black eyes, everything.
Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black. Everything you need, better believe you are that. Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black.
Every time they hear this, they gon' say he made a hand. The life ain't a pan, the shit ain't black and white, it's a canvas. Spike Lee your dreams and Bruce Lee your tantrums. Took me that bullshit and go Michael Jordan, go Samson. Knock down the walls around me, strong and dark and so handsome. Everything around me is shining dark and the time is divine. I find a spark when the clouds leak and the rain falling, I found peace. Black as the concrete, black as the street, the night with the palm tree. I'm black as the night sky when you broken your...
It just don't mean black is the bottom of Chuck Taylor. Black is the fuck hate. Black is the burnt rubber hitting doors in front of the store with 2 months later. They got black in the top front of black burner under the seat.
What happened?
It stopped sharing. We can't see the video anymore. There we go.
Case closed, now your life on the back burner.
Black magic.
Black magic.
Black excellence.
Black excellence.
Black habits.
Black habits.
It's black medicine.
Yeah.
Everything.
Black chucks. Black chucks. Everything.
Everything.
Black hug. Black love. Everything.
Praise black Jesus.
Yeah.
Play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still give black roses. Everything.
Black child. Black ride.
Everything. Black pride. Black lives. Everything.
What is doing that? Am I doing that?
Friends noir, here you are, black. Everything you need, better believe you are that. Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black. Everything you need, better believe you are that, yeah.
Mira negritos, puro amor pa mis morenitos.
sea un giro, cambiando idioma. Vuelve palomas encima de rollercoaster, cae cerca de la playa, ocean view. Black of the berry, the sweeter the juice. We dancing in soca too. Only fuck with few real niggas to chill with us, build with us, to deal with. Never pull the trigger, aiming at another man, but real hitters still pick up the phone. I ain't on this mission alone. Used to dream of really stacking my funds. Now my window's just as black as my gun. I feel divine. It came on time. God never changes, ain't gon' lie. I lost faith and cried, then my faith revived. And as soon as I let go and surrendered to him my talents, this young king took off like go-go gadget. There go that black magic.
Black excellence, black habits. This black medicine. Everything black.
Black chucks, black chucks, everything.
Everything black.
Black hood, black love, everything.
Praise black Jesus, play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still hear black roses. Everything black.
Black tribe, black ride, everything.
Everything black.
Black pride, black lives, everything.
So, as y'all saying in the comments, it feels very different to me, the humility, the beauty, there's the elegance about it. And to have him, instead of, you know, renting, you know, land to make a music video for a demonstration, to actually show what it's like to go back and, you know, own the land that your ancestors own is a powerful statement. So I appreciate that. Here's another one. I liked some young people. I'm not sure where they're from. I'm going to try to track this down so I could share the sources of this with y'all.
When we come to Washington in this campaign, we're coming to get our check.
Reparation, Martin said we coming for our check. Reparation, say it loud, one, two, mic, check. Cream, cash rules everything around me. Dream, my legacy, you can't stop me. Coming for our 40 acres, H.I. 40 in our paper.
Kicking the door.
Martin said we coming for our check. Reparations, say it loud. One, two, mic, check. Cream, cash rules everything around me. Dream, my legacy, you can't stop me. Coming for our 40 acres, H.I. 40 in our
look,
paper.
We taking them back. Putting Pettus Bridge on the map. Police came with the strap. That Sunday was bloody, no cap.
Stop capping.
Speaking of cap, Kaepernick taking knees at the flag. Where my justice at? We built this nation, better give me them racks. All fat, just a match and a little bit of gasoline. Four girls got bombed back in 63.
400 years, yeah, we still ain't free. I rise,
we rise. Taking knees. Kaepernick. Reparation, Martin said we coming for our check. Reparation, say it loud. One, two, mic, check. Cream. Cash rules everything around me. Dream. My legacy, you can't stop me.
Coming for our 40 acres. We stuck in the trap, with no shoes, trying to pull up bootstraps. Increasing the gap, wealth got bigger, so we had to adapt. Discriminated cause we black, I know it worth more than I know it's a fact. They trying to feed scraps, drag me on board so we can't come back.
30 years ago on April 19, Yousef and Trey the chemical read.
If it happened to them, think it happened to me. It's humans out ready, 5, 2, and 3.
Prodigy.
Reparation, Martin said we coming for our check.
Love it. It's obvious why I love that one the most. I think that was it. I want to introduce our special guest today. What is it? Oh, real quick. Kanye West.
I'm giving up my slave name. I'm giving up my slave name. Say
saint. You don't really need a last name. No, you don't really need a last name. I'm giving up my saint.
I don't know what he did with that song. It was a clip that surfaced of him starting a song about giving up a slave name. I would love for him to finish that song. I think it would be profound coming from him. Anyway, I've talked enough. I wanted to introduce Tatiana Lane. Met her about a year or so ago at an organization she started called Mental Health Meets Hip Hop. So she was the first person I thought about when Blue Door asked to do this series around hip hop wellness, because she's is in the field, the mental health worker herself. She's also a prolific writer and really connected to artists in Chicago and around the country, bringing in fresh perspectives around doing that integration of culture, arts, and mental health conversation. So I want to introduce her and ask her if she has something to share on this topic. I don't know if she does or does not, but I think that she probably does, because MC's always got bars on them. So if you can introduce yourself, I would love for you to share your organization first, talk about how the organization started, and then if you got a piece you can leave with us, that would be perfect.
Okay, how you doing, guys? My name is Tatiana Lane. I also go by the artist name of Miss Tati. I started Mental Health Meets Hip Hop about 3 to 4 years ago. And just to kind of bridge the gap, because I'm a mental health professional, but I'm also an artist. So, you know, I'm heavily rooted in the music. I did music before I even went to school for psychology. Yeah, so I mean, my perspective is just hip hop. You know, me starting Mental Health Meets Hip Hop was not only about the music, but about the culture. It's about the way we talk, the way we dress, the way we think, the language that we use in our communities to express what's going on in our communities. So it's a transparent way of, you know, storytelling and just bringing out the truth and what, you know, mainstream media or even organizations like to shun or, you know, denounce and things like that. But I just think telling the story of slavery through hip hop has always been from sometimes slavery is told through us historically through a place of defeat and, you know, not triumph or being resilient. And I know for myself, being an indigenous woman here in Chicago, I triumph every day, you know, through everything that I do. So I like to tell stories from that point of view, and not necessarily what the stereotypical story of slavery is. I mean, I don't feel defeated and like we just, you know, stood by and got beat. You know, I don't feel like that. I don't feel like I came from that. So I think it's up to me to tell the stories from my ancestors that I believe are more so empowering.
Beautiful. How do you use hip hop in the therapy setting? Do you use it in therapy? Is it in workshops? Mm-hmm. How can hip hop enhance the mental health work? Besides like talk therapy or workshops, like what is it that music does? It gives a different advantage for you.
Mm-hmm. Well, hip hop allows me to speak the language in which the community understands. So at Mental Health Meets Hip Hop, we denounce the clinical terminology. Although okay. We use it because we are trained mental health professionals, we speak in a language that makes the individual comfortable. So I know a lot of workshops that we utilize, we don't want to talk more so because, I mean, mental illness is still a stigma in our community. A lot of people don't believe in it. They don't know what it is. And just to be honest, I mean, we don't trust, you know, anybody. You know, from a lot of perspectives, at least individuals outside of the community. So
when you denounce clinical language, give me an example. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
Denouncing clinical language, meaning that we're not using every therapeutic approach, intervention clinically that's documented in books as a way to get inside of people's minds to make people more transparent. Mm-hmm. For example, the mental health professionals I work with, we all come from the inner city in Chicago. So you know, Austin, Lawndale, Inglewood, and we're going to talk to the individuals that need therapy and need help in that manner. So I'm not talking clinically and in book smart to everyone, although we have the knowledge. We're going to talk just as if, you know, we're there with the people, which we are in the communities.
Mm-hmm. What about lyrics specifically? Do you have people write? Do you use your ability, your skills, talent? And do you have something you can share with us today that fits the theme?
Always. I'm always using my talent. I have people write. We do workshops. We also do open mics. We also do writing skills that help express emotional intelligence and things like that. So every component of mental health meets hip hop connects back to the root of some type of therapeutic intervention.
I love it. You ready to drop? I need a DJ to get you to drop some bars. I was going to play some drums. I don't know if the sound is going to sync. We didn't get to practice that. But if you got a piece you can share with us, with the family, I would love for you to drop 16 for it.
I definitely got some bars. Okay. Stop believing them lies. You ain't meant to be played. I told you a king and queen, but you think you was a slave. They tricked you out your land. Please have some common sense. When you got melanin in your skin, they think you incompetent. See, you gotta know the truth. You think they hung all them bodies and nobody broke the noose? What's good for the gander is greater for the goose. That's why they erased all your history and burnt up the roots. Why when you tell the truth, the first thing they do is shoot? Tell you about the bodies that was hung, but not the ones that ran until they was free. The same kings and queens, the same color as you and me. I mean, at this point, I'm freestyling.
Yes. Beautiful.
Yeah.
I love it. Now, that's dope. We're going to please stay around. We're going to open the floor real soon just to open up for conversations, for questions. She's going to be a part of this series. So, like, you'll see her more and more. She's got connections to lots of dope artists that we're going to be leaning on to bring in to introduce y'all to. So thank you for being here. Please stick around for a little bit. Let me go back to these slides real quick. I'm going to wrap up this presentation so we can open up the floor for this discussion. And what I wanted to end with is some of the materials that I use. I have created a curriculum called Manifest. It's primarily with young Black men. Started in juvenile detention centers, JTDC, off of Roosevelt. And I had a unit in here where I talk about this question of history and how we got to this place. And my intention the whole time was to never show pictures of lynchings, to never talk about that part of the story, but still be able to help them see, you know what I'm saying, where we come from. I start with this song. I'll play a little bit of this. Twin Savage song, where he's talking about this idea of history repeating itself, that nothing is new. And that I want the young people to really get that concept, but also help us think through what can happen to unravel, to undo the cycles, and to get a better sense of where the cycles come from. So 21 Savage, I think, speaks to some of those issues in a really powerful way. So I start this unit with that song.
You have Hillary, who's called Black teens or Black kids super predators. You have Donald Trump, who's openly racist.
Is there any regret that you got into a name-calling situation with the president?
No.
Trying to remind folks, think about the pain that he may be expressing about somebody who's lost a loved one that they think was unfairly shot.
Thank you for having me. Obviously, an awful, awful day for our entire country, yet another senseless tragedy right here at home.
This is Daphne Evans reporting live at the Brown residence. Justin Brown was mistaken as a suspect in a recent robbery. Looks like another unarmed Black man gunned down again.
Awful, awful day for our entire country, yet another senseless tragedy right here.
Do you have the information?
You know, I did talk to law enforcement today. I know there's going to be a press conference with the governor. I don't have additional details to provide beyond what they have said until that press conference. I will say that I happen to be on the road near that area this morning.
They thought I only rapped about worrying pills. I'm trying to feed my family. I ain't being political. You ain't giving out money, then they look at you pitiful. You make a couple million, niggas greedy or envy. I fuck that other side, we gon' shoot up your sprinter. I used to sell that crack and spray that neck out that rim. Fat niggas running high when I brought out that rim. Got a stendo and a hoodie, he can't wait till December. Got a stendo and a hoodie, he gon' shoot you on camera. Lost his faith in Jesus Christ, he praying to a bandana. Cody's gun, his brother down, and she too hard to handle. Loading up his chopper, he gon' show him Black Lives Matter. That nigga made the news, ain't nothing new, nah. He done dropped out of school, it ain't nothing new, nah. He done got his first tool, it ain't nothing new, nah. Mama on that dog food, it ain't nothing new, nah. He smoking weed and he changing, it ain't nothing new, nah. I
college friends gang banging, it ain't nothing new. Got a pocket full of hundreds and they all blue. Another nigga from the hood trying to bow to.
Nah, for real.
Shit getting outrageous. Treat us like slaves and they lock us up in cages. Young black poor ain't had a father since a baby. Why you think we skip school and hang out on the pavement? Why you think we ride around with choppers out safe? Why streets cut throat, nigga, so I'm cut broke. I used to sell dope, nigga, now I can't vote. Poppin' Percocets to kill the pain, I can't cope. Anger in my jeans, they used to hang us up with ropes. Civil rights came, so they flood the hood with coke. Breaking down my people, trying to kill our faith and hope. They killed Martin Luther King, and all he did was spoke. Welcome to the hood, yeah, where niggas dying in. Same place where the best chicken getting fried at. Same place where the police killing, telling lies at. It ain't just the babies, man, I swear the mama's crying at. Another nigga made the news, ain't nothing new.
So I start with that song just to talk about the cycles and historical context and intergenerational trauma to make that point. And then to broaden the context for Black history from the 1619 moment. You know, this point is important by itself, just the audacity of the Make America Great Again slogan. But then right here, I have a chart. It's a chart by Tony Browder. He has a timeline of Black history, African history from the first human. And you rolled it out. It's a very long. It takes like three people to hold it up. And you see like the thousands of years pre 1619, the African people have been on the planet and the things we've done. And you get to see on the chart where like the Greeks came on the scene. You see Plato and Aristotle like halfway through this chart. And for thousands of years, like dynasties rising and falling on Africa by itself. So I just wanted them to have that framework before we even continue the conversation about what happened to us in this context, because it's a very small context. And some of the artists that they listen to sort of know about this. It's a little Yachty, got a shirt. Repping Ivan Van Sertum's book, Came Before Columbus, talking about the African people that were traveling the world before Christopher Columbus so-called discovered it. This is the trailer I used to show talking about African civilizations from Henry Louis Gates' documentary did. But then I do deal with that the disruption, right? So I think we need to talk about slavery and tell that story. But the way I do it, is very careful about the language. So this is a trick question I asked: how many slaves did the terrorists bring from African Americans? The answer to the question is zero. Because they were people, they were farmers and fathers and teachers and workers and whatever it was. And I use terrorists to talk about the people that did it, to reframe just the way we have made terrorists Arabs, just in the news. And so people that created terror for people for generations, you know, to use that language for. But then when I ask about this question around what they learned about how they perceived that trauma impacting the United States, the Americas, that they have very small numbers of guesses of how many people were brought from Africa. I've heard hundreds. Most of the young people I ask, they say thousands. So when I be like, I've seen the minimum of 40 million, upwards of 20 million, is what people think about the numbers of people that were taken from Africa. And I show some of the images. So I don't show lynchings, but I do have some images that I found to make a couple of points. One is that their children, they were targeted. Their enemies were so weak, they couldn't even like fight man to man. They were kidnapping kids. And that this was so recent in our history that cameras was invented. So that I have them put this in their mind. What does it look like to have a ship full of hundreds of people, children a lot of the times? And then I play this chart. So I do want them to think about the gravity of the trauma of what the Ma'afa represents. So instead of showing like the lynching sort of story, I just show this chart, which some of you may have seen this already. It's a diagram that shows even before 1619, the passage, right, the transatlantic slave trade. And for as the years go along, every dot you see coming from different parts of the continent is a ship. Like it represents, so they have that image in their mind already of a ship full of hundreds of people. And then each one of these dots represents that whole ship. I usually ask them to watch this in silence just to really like honor what's happening to, because it's hard to conceive of this. Like as I'm talking, we're talking about thousands of bodies. And as it goes along, like it's hard to even like hold in your mind the gravity of what this image is representing. But we show the chart. I'll play it to this end just so you can see, you know, the impact of what this visual looks like when we talk about telling this story of the trauma of enslavement for our people. So the chart ends here, 1860. Lots of points that can be made from this visual depiction. And I know, like, even for me, like, it's hard to even, after a while, like, when is this going to end? Like, what am I even looking at? My brain can't even hold this image right now, let alone the mammoth, like, trauma that happened to our people, what it meant to drain that many people out of Africa, what it means for, what I saw in some of my studies was as low as 4% of them landing in what we now call United States. That, why does it look like? Black Africa in Haiti and in Jamaica and Brazil and Colombia and these kind of places, what does it mean to have an African diaspora? Like, this chart just depicts that very, very, very clearly. And how, you know, it's a boat ride away from connecting us to family all around the world that might be very different, might speak different languages, only because we were captured by people that were in that country. So people speak Portuguese now because they were taken from the Portuguese. People speak Spanish now, but, like, we really are one people in a way that I think could be a really powerful story for this, this part of our history. These are some images of Black Mexicans, right, just to drive that point home. But then the rest of the time, I spend the whole time talking about resistance. So when I talk about what happened to us, I spend the rest of the time talking about how we happened back, how we come from people that were always fighting, that were always rebelling. This is one film to, you know, give another visual depiction of that. Came about the same year 12 Years a Slave came out, but didn't get as much press, certainly didn't win any awards. Danny Glover's in it. I'll play this too.
Now, you see, Father, Master got us working on Sunday. I just want to know who go to hell for it.
I think you'll be okay.
The God is not interested in me or anything colored around here. Master, we can't keep on like this.
You look at me in the eye, boy. Need I remind you of your place?
Tula, they're free. The French have done away with slavery.
We should be free by law. What the hell goes on here?
You're from St. Nicholas. Come to join the robot. Where's the one that I call Tula?
All these slaves running around here got something today they didn't have yesterday. And they got it from you.
This revolt cannot continue on much longer.
The government is determined to force you back. You cannot win this battle.
We just want our freedom.
This has gone on long enough. We'll starve them out.
Every single man, woman, and child. It stands with me tonight, you are already free.
It's what I do. Freedom! Freedom!
This is Usher down in the island where that statue is, honoring that ancestor. But, you know, the whole story, the point is that resistance was a part of that, this slave story. It's not just a, it was getting beat. It's not just a whole, yes, sir, master. It was a story of power. It's a story of brilliance, of resilience. This is a clip of different uprisings they may not have heard of. I make the point that America likes to reward and enforce the lynching stories. But I'm never going to take my kid to a lynching museum. I don't even want them to have this image in their brain. So as much as I can, I try to. Spend time with the chart of the trauma of all the ships that came over, that like torture ships. Like, I need to see that. But I also need to see, this is a chart that shows insurrections in the States from 1526 to 1864. And it has the same sort of feel. Like after a while, you start to see all these individual moments. Maybe Nat Turner, maybe Denmark Vesey, but like, it's hundreds and hundreds, thousands, you could argue, of names that like, people that, you know, fought for their freedom, that just that did not submit to the terror that slavery was. And I want young people to have that, like to know that, to stand in that, to be firm in that, to want to seek these stories out and connect themselves to that, because there's a power here that I think that we need still. One page, it's like 50 pages. That like the resistance was always diverse. So whatever you into, you got to find a way to connect that to a resistance movement, to social justice movements. That even in the worst of our times, they were using quilts and braiding hairs, and you know, using messages. Whether using the field or the house, that you found ways to defend yourself by stopping working or hiding music and messages and songs, leaving, joining forces with natives, and starting Seminole Wars. It's all different ways. It wasn't just men. If they get the impression that we're talking about men, I play this video of different women warriors throughout history, and just make this, you know, these three to take on points. We've always resisted. Our resistance has always been diverse, and it never stopped. But then I end by talking about the mental health implications of this generation of this trauma. Sometimes I play a clip of Joy DeGruy's theory talking about post-traumatic. Play this version of artists, hip hop, are talking about some of those ideas, some of the impact of enslavement over the generations. This guy's name, King Los. I think he's from the West Coast.
Yeah. I'm from a block with a method. With him, and taught in every school to disconnect you from your culture, like everything cool. See what having low. Means we diametrically oppose, yo. I hope this message electrifies. The European be leveraging privilege through ethnic bias. Yes. If you ain't do no scholarship on this, don't dare speak. University's pledge Greek. It just isn't in your favor. It's a sick, twisted, sadistic, ritualistic nature. Look. You think it's odd they slaved you? If the slave master ain't served the same God they gave you? 400 years. Hold up. Yeah, hold up. Look. You think it's odd they slave you? If the slave master ain't served the same God they gave you? 400 years later, and you hardly stable, and you turn around and beg that same God to save you? Look, word to the sunrise. Homie, save yourself. Everything else, get a thumb drive. The young lives of black queens lost, misplaced, who've been raped, beaten, indoctrinated, and disgraced. We've been wet, shackled, and mutilated, put through degradation, disrespectfully viewed and hated. I mean truly flagrant, treated like shit in this fucking nation. Then in 1850, slaveholders came with this publication called How to Make the Ideal Slave. Now dig the vision. Rule number one was unconditional submission. Keep them in place. With authority, because rule number two was create inferiority, and Ye said that slavery was a truth, real clear. Rule three was take away their voice and instill fear, and hell yeah, I could see the passion in your eyes. I admire your perseverance for your fashion and your grind, but rule number four is why that hat was our demise. You keep the slave interested in the master's enterprise, because rule number five was the province of education, information, recreation. Look.
low. You listening to me?
Teacher, we listen.
To the promise of information. That's a psychological prison. Niggas have yet to come out because of slaves court. Man, hold up. That's a psychological prison. Niggas have yet to come out. If the slave master caught you learning, they cut your tongue out. Y'all hear me?
Yes. Yes.
If the slave master caught you learning, they cut your tongue out. The segregation 100 years was so thorough. No wonder so many kids on drugs in this cold world. Niggas, shout out J. Cole.
Yeah. Mind blown.
Look, hold up. I go off the top with an op.
So, that's King Lo. On in and out. Y'all could miss some of that. Can y'all hear me? Am I still here?
Yes, we got you. We hear you.
Okay. I'm going to wrap this up then. So what were you just saying, Nakia, about the video going in and out? That last video or all of them?
Just like the last two.
Okay. I don't know what to do about that. I'm going to skip this video then, so we can open the floor soon to have some discussion. This is short. I'm going to see if this works. This is the last video because it's a hip hop form. I got to play the rappers. This guy's from Chicago. And I use this video to talk about Black history more contemporarily after we talk about the safe moment. This is an artist out of Chicago also. I'm trying to bring him in for one of these sessions too. He got a lot of really cool music. And then I'll wrap this thing up. See if it works.
Hey, Gula, Gula, GC, you know, here go a little bit of what I wrote to the TI We Will Not, okay? Rock with me. Hey, look, it's a new day and look if you tired, be done with that marching and asking your enemy. Better what we look like asking devils for a blessing. Never left us cool niggas think that they can change them. My people still ain't learned their lesson. I ain't sugarcoating nothing. Take it wrong. Get too emotional, you might miss the message. Hey, I ain't with the begging. We can do it on our own. It's a lot of Black people getting paid. Talking about the shit we ain't got and the shit we need. But we spend our money with white people every day. And until we get our own, yeah, I understand. We gon' have to deal with them. Cool, cool, touche. But it's Black people that'll buy white all year. And never even think to buy Black one day. Gotta change the culture. We divided, but together we stronger. You my brother, that's all I need to know, because when it comes to fighting this world, we're going to need plenty of soldiers, and the goal is to win as a whole, don't lose focus. When I check the bag, I'm spinning it on acres, then I got to get... They try to send martial law, we need training. Believe I'ma die by mine, I'm not playing. They plot to kill us, take the real ones, keep us scared so people won't retaliate. Even though it's more of us than them, we full of fear, so we just contemplate. But not no more, look, not today. My people rising up, cause look, the times have changed. Look, we are not our grandparents. Shit you used to get away with, we gon' tolerate.
Then I end sort of in that notion. Actually, I actually don't even like that idea. We are not a grandparent sentiment. I appreciate the passion of the young people and the find it, but I think it's ahistorical. I think it's out of context, and that even if they conceive of the civil rights movement, the nonviolent folks, that this image just reminds us of, it took a lot of courage to prepare yourself, right? To prepare themselves to deal with the hate and the violence, putting their bodies on the line at the sit-ins and the freedom rides. So that wasn't like a weak moment in our history, and our grandparents weren't passive because of it. Like, it was just a different strategy. And at the same time, there were always Black people that were talking about armed resistance, the Black Panther Party, they back in the news, and getting more attention because of the Judas and Messiah movie, which I really appreciate. But even them being militant is, you know, not the full story who they in their name. It had self-defense. Their position was just that you can't come into the house and I'd not be armed if you're trying to attack my children. I mean, it was a very simple idea. But more than just, so I want to encourage us to think about teaching Black history from the diversity of what African people represented. So the founder had a PhD, they studied their laws, they had schools, they had healthcare clinics, free breakfast programs, they gave clothes away. So again, the message always is, we've always come from a diverse, resilient, resistant people. That there was never a moment when we were just like taking it, that we just gave in. And that I think there's ways to tell these stories and to honor that part of our history that highlights. African, what they've been, what they tried to fight back, what they've been marching with King, what they and do this here is because they everybody would have been Nat Turner in their imagination. Everybody says they would have been on the front lines, all of it. So this leads up to the conversation we have next about present day activism, the need to continue to build towards social justice and have wellness be a part of it, but there still be opposition that we need to fight for. And then we can attach ourselves to these legacies. And I'm done. Perfect. We have at least 18 minutes. So this is the part. It's a lot of information. I know we just shared a whole bunch of stuff. And Ms. Tati's still here, and we got a bunch of clinicians and historians in the room. I just wanted to give a moment to take a breath again and synthesize all of these points and talk about ways that we can use them in our work, ways that we can promote the good and still not lose the trauma, but like do it in a way that reinforces power and pride and connection to our ancestors and to our history. So y'all are welcome to take your mics off, and if you have questions or comments or reflections or ideas, things you want to share or objections or challenges, this would be the time. We got the last 15 minutes. We want to have an open discussion about all of these things.
I want to say something, Barry, right fast because I have to leave. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Kim? Okay, so I wanted to say when the first artist, you know, Black Creative Production, that's one of my areas of specialties in African-American studies, right?
Introduce yourself real quick, please.
Oh, I am Dr. Kim Delaney, and I am a professor of African-American studies at Chicago State University and the director of education and program at DuSable Museum. And so I wanted to say that about music, this is so powerful to me because we get lost sometimes in the language. Like if I love hearing language raw. I love hearing music raw. My son has a production company. He produces with guys, little guys on the West Side that he has taken off the street, you know, and they're making a living. So I am, I don't celebrate bad language. You know, I'm familiar with Jake Ruther and with good speech and things like that, but I'm also listening for core concepts. So I'm listening for what you're talking about. Are you talking about communalism? Communalism? Are you talking about helping each other? Are you talking about survival? What are you talking about? I understand the language that you speak, and I speak the same language as well. So I speak that language. It's where I come from. So I know that language, and I can translate it in either world, either of the worlds, I should say, that I enter. But it's important to note that we have to look for core concepts, not communication styles, just like if we were in another country. And I know sometimes it's problematic for people because it's negative, it seems negative, but we have to meet people in that space. So if you're talking about survival and you feel you're in a war, I think it's okay that you're using language that shows that you think you're in a war. Now, how I can meet you and see if I can provide some of the tools that help you feel safe, or that you can eat off of or do whatever, that's what I have to do. But I can't, while you're struggling to survive, we have to acknowledge that that's what that is. And that's what they're talking about. They're talking about war, you know. And one of the songs I love, I'm gonna say like that, one of the songs I love, the guy said, they ain't bringing no food. 21 Savage said that. Like, they not feeding you, they not bring. That's what I hear from young people all the time. Like, you telling us to don't do this, but you're not offering options. You know what I'm saying? And so I think it's important to look at the core concepts. I love the presentation and your approach. And I love that you show all the different, I mean, we can unpack one song and have a whole class on it, you know, on what it's really saying,
Right. I appreciate that. I don't want to start a debate right now. I am curious to know about the elders' position on the N-word specifically. Not you necessarily. Like, I know you got to go. I don't want to create no mess. But like, I love the language too. I'm perfectly fine using it. But I know that there's, you know, it's hard, particularly from folks that were around at the time when the N-word meant something different, to hear young people use it so blazingly. That's one of the things that, you know, I personally struggle with in terms of my own position around that. I go back and forth on it. But Any other comments? Thanks, Dr. Delaney, for sharing that and for bringing your class today. Anybody else want to share something? Thoughts, comments, reflections?
Can I would love to say something to the last point.
Yeah.
So I just feel like with the young people right now, the way in which that word is utilized and even by like outside races is very common. It's very common.
Common? Okay.
Common.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like they don't have the same level of respect for that word.
Yeah.
Or not respect. Let me not say that. The same level of what is supposed to be due when saying that word, if you're going to say it, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like they don't care. And I feel like it's a very big problem because if it's a trend that's going that way, then, you know, who knows where we'll be in the next 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that I feel like is very concerning.
Mm-hmm. I hear you.
Because I don't have an older generation perspective about it, about mm-hmm. using the internet. I do have, like, I just feel like nobody's not Black is not supposed to say it. But for some reason, Cardi B get a pass. But yeah, like.
You muted yourself. I think Cardi B muted you. She's that powerful.
She probably did. She probably did. She probably did. So I just feel like, you know, for some reason, like she gets a pass and it's like, you know, but it's still not okay. You know what I mean?
I hear you.
So that's my thoughts on the use of the N-word. I ain't even talking about what I saw because I want every list of every song and every movie because I wasn't able to hear the whole time because it was coming in and out. And I would love to look up some of the lyrics and stuff like that and kind of have like a whole list that I can like do a little research into and stuff like that because I wasn't able to take it in everything, you know. So, but thank you for hosting this.
Yeah, I can provide a list for all the songs, the clips, sure. Anybody else have any questions, comments, ideas, thoughts, reflections?
As do I. I does have questions. If you can see me or hear me, I don't know.
I can hear you. I can't see you. I'm not sure where the voice is coming from. It's kind of like, sounds like God right now, coming from the ethers.
Hello.
There you go, Shaquan.
Indeed, it is me.
What's good, bro?
So, in terms of the N-word, that is a very, very nitpicky kind of thing, especially if I'm going to touch on the Cardi B thing. Because if we talk about the, like, Atlantic slave trades and the European slave trades and just all of these, even like the Louisiana Purchase and all of that. It's like a lot of people's culture is like embedded with Black and Black. I'm gonna have to do this because then we get really confused on because there's people who are of we could consider African American, but they're actually native to either South America or they're native to the land of America. And then, you know, if we like great example is like you have French Creole people, but then you have Louisiana Creole people or Haitian Creole people. And mm-hmm. like in the French Creole people are like, they're more of the white kind of mixed people, whereas the Louisiana or the Haitian Creole people are more of the ones who have Black background. And then you have like the white past Hispanics, the Afro Latinos, and then like the Latinos who mm-hmm. were more oppressed and, embedded with European or Spaniard, which is European genetics, or the Afro Latinos who have like the slavery background as well of the Black culture and African Americans and whatnot. So this is just. That's always real, just weird. I know with me personally, I try not to say the N-word simply because that using, like, all words are powerful. If I expect to another Black man that he is a nigga or whatever, then that's how I think of him, but mm-hmm. I think of other Black people as my family from, like, no matter if we was born by blood, you share a basic culture with me, so you're my brother, you're my sister, so I refer to you as such, you know? So it's like, I try personally not to say it simply because I know that the weight of the word has meaning, no matter if we turn it into endearment, it still has a background to it, mm-hmm. to where it's like, you act like a nigga, you get treated like a nigga. So it's like, I'm not going to treat you like no nigga because you my brother or you mm-hmm. my sister, and I want better for you, just like I want better for myself.
I got you. That makes sense to me. I do think words carry a lot of reference, for sure. No, that's very
broad.
I appreciate that. Thank you, brother, man. Anybody else? Is that Larry Turner raising your hand? Yes, sir. Dr. Turner? You muted, bro. Doc, sir, elder, Baba.
See, I'm so old school, I can't even unmute myself.
You made it up. You found the link.
Anyway, you know, it's language is very, very important. And sometimes it's hard to get past the words, so it's always nice to have the artist there to explain what it means. Like when I didn't write down that one brother song, where he had all these scantily clad sisters, and then he tried to throw some slavery in there. It would have been nice to see what he was trying to get across. But I think you can use hip hop. I mean, years ago, I mean, Tupac made, you remember Brenda's Got a Baby?
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful song. Beautiful yeah. song. And Tupac used to cuss, you know, and put stuff out yeah. there. And that was a song that you could take apart and talk with young people on. And Miss Tati, am I saying your name right, sister? All right. When she did her rap, that was beautiful, and it was something that you could, you know, after she does the rap, if it was written down, like you had some kids there, you could go mm-hmm. over mm-hmm. and say, hey, what do you mean? You know, mm-hmm. because, you know, but I guess, you know, it would be nice to see what the artists themselves. Especially that one movie where the sister was, all the sisters were there and stuff, you know, see what he was just throwing something in there or what.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
Okay. That's all from the old school.
Thank you, Dr. Turner. Thanks for being here. Thanks for stomaching it, lasting all this hippity hop for an hour. Anybody else have anything they wanted to share? We got a couple minutes left.
Real quick, just to explore, you know, the N-word. I think when we think about who controls the media and who really highlights artists in hip hop nowadays on mainstream media, the N-word is almost reverse psychology. It's just like the word, the B-I-T-C-H word, right? They try to make it cool where they try to trick you into calling yourself these things, and then you are... start, you know, we have some coaches that really act like ignorant, like what the word means, but then we have some people that try to take the power away from the word. Like Tupac years ago came up with the acronym for nigga, never ignorant, getting goals accomplished. So I think a lot of people in hip-hop try to take away things that they call us and try to put empowerment behind it. But I think too, as artists, we still have to thread lightly on that path, because you know, you ultimately speak what you become. So I believe in word magic, you know. The power of words weigh heavy. But I guess it's behind what's the intent behind it. Because it could be a power of endearment, just like the word brother and sister was back in the 60s. So I'm kind of in between with that.
Patty, if I may. Like, you're definitely right, because it's, a lot of people don't know this, but, you know, I'm a skater as well, so, like, there's a skate brand that doesn't really happen anymore, but it's called DGK. That stands for Dirty Ghetto Kids. And the cool part of that brand was, it was a group of Black kids who went to a skate park with white kids, and all the white kids kept calling them Dirty Ghetto Kids. So they was like, you know what? That's what we're going to be. You know what I'm saying? That's not a problem. You know what I'm saying? We skate better than y'all. y'all can call it Dirty Killer Kids, whatever, you know what I'm saying? And they made a whole franchise out of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's definitely, like, true. It's like, we do take, I mean, look at almost everything that we've done. We've always taken a negative and tried to flip it and make it a positive, you know? And then people like Rob Deferred, you know, nigga to niggas, meaning royalty and stuff like that. So it's like, we definitely do try to do that, but it's like, we are, like you said, the media controls most of it. So the percentage of the ones who are trying to make it empowered is definitely not as broad as the ones who don't really give a crap.
Yeah.
I agree. I love it. Great conversation. I got one last comment we can make before Blue Door has to wrap us up. If anybody has any burning statements or things they want to express before we go, speak now or forever peace, or we can wrap right here. I'm satisfied with this conversation. We good? I'll pause for a second. Okay, cool. Well, please make sure you follow Tatiana Lane and her organization. She should put the Instagram and website into the chat. All of your emails to the Chicago Association of Black Psychologies list, so you see more about upcoming events. The next installment of this series will be March something. I don't think we have a date yet. I'm thinking we're going to talk about something around women's health. Oh, we do have a day. We talk about this, women's wellness. We have some really interesting questions about that. Some similar dynamics where hip hop portrays images of women and uses language as women that women have to, I don't know, navigate in ways that we got artists that are in the field that are just taking hits over and over again. And then there's a new sort of sexual revolution that I think that has less of, we need to be careful about. So I want to bring some women together to help us with that conversation, because I'm in a room with boys trying to help them see this stuff. But like, I'll be like, you hear that song? That's terrible. Look at these lyrics. And then they like, but that's my sister's favorite song. And then the conversation's over, right? So these things, I need help with these. So we're gonna sort of delve into some of these songs, lyrics, musics, and images around women's identity and health. So come back for that. I will not talk as much, I promise, next time, and it'll be much more open forums for us to dig into some of these things. But just had to get some of those, had to get these slides out, these songs out. So thank y'all so much. I'm hoping that Blue Door does not fire us and cancel the series because we said the N-word several times and showed images of Black people killing white people. But they was like, go ahead, do it. So we did it. And now we hope that we can continue. Thank you, Nakia. Thank you, Blue Door. Thank you, community, for being here. Thank you, Tatiana. And we'll be back next month.
Thank you, Dr. Cartman. Have a good night, everyone. Thanks, Blue
Door. Thank you all for joining us. See you soon.
Okay, good night. Thank you.
Good night.